say, let the floodgates of wisdom be opened. And so the Lord does say, the floodgates of wisdom shall be opened unto those who have completed their training on the first ray, their training under El Moria, Archangel Michael, God Mercury, Hercules, and Amazonia. Let those who embody and are obedient to the will of God, to them let the floodgates of wisdom be opened. Thus, there is a qualification as there has been, beloved, since the coming of Alpha and Omega, of Lord Gautama Buddha, of Helios and Vesta, in a number of dictations, whereby the dispensations in the earth have been restricted to those who are the bearers of the light. This is not discrimination, beloved. This is divine discrimination on the part of those who sponsor the light in the earth. For those who have squandered the light and failed their tests, they then shall wait until another day to receive light and sponsorship again. For after all, neither we, the Elohim of God, or any other of the ascended hosts desire to be tied to planet Earth for eons and eons and eons to come. So you see, beloved, the very sponsorship by gurus ascended and unascended is predicated upon the willingness of gurus to tarry with the earth and her evolutions. Thus you wonder and marvel at the presence of your Sanat Kumara and the holy Kumaras, and we marvel also. But because of his example, many lesser beings who are ascended masters, Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, and even archangels have tarried with the earth. So I tell you at the very commencement of our address to you this day that you know not what great and deep gratitude you ought to have for Sanat Kumara, who has set the pace in carrying the standard of determining not to leave Earth's evolutions, not to do so, beloved ones, and all the many others of the Great White Brotherhood have therefore followed suit. Thus I ask you to give indeed a standing ovation to Sanat Kumara. Indeed, Sanat Kumara is the keystone in the arch of the entire planetary systems, and if you knew this entire solar system, so be seated, beloved ones, that I might instruct you in the Logos, that is the logic of the law itself. Why then do some have brilliance of mind? Why do some have facility with matters of study and understanding of the way in which the universe works? Well, I tell you, beloved, in some cases and in many cases, it is because their love of the will of God and their submission to that will has given to them full access to the mind of God, for these are trusted servants who on their honor and by their inner balance and inner determination would never, never misuse the power of God, the law of God, and the ray of that will itself. So then, beloved, these chelas who have made themselves servants of those who are the Manus, of Vaivasvata Manu, of the god and goddess Meru and Lord Himalaya, those who have come under the great divine director, these students of the law and lovers of the will of God, who will meditate upon that law day and night, as the psalmist wrote, they come to the place where the floodgates of wisdom are opened unto them, for they can be entrusted with knowledge of how things work. The how then becomes the secrets of the mysteries of God that are revealed through the cosmic Christ intelligence and the mind of God, which is then superimposed upon the chakras and upon the human brain. So you see, beloved, those who live in the will of God will find extraordinary resources available to them through the Holy Spirit. And I speak not merely of academic learning, but of the knowledge of the deep things of God, because such ones are deep, deeply involved in the mysteries of God's will and the path, deeply involved and concerned as to the outcome of all of the light bearers of the earth and the evolutions as well. Those who have compassion, the compassion of the Holy Spirit, and have paid their dues on the first ray, they shall know this day in the earth, in the etheric octave, in the retreats, wherever they are, they shall know a new wisdom, a new wise dominion, a new self-knowledge, a new ability to unfold the fairest flower of the blossoming of the Christ and of the seed of the Buddha in the mind. Yes, beloved, wisdom is a gift that must be earned, and that well earned. Some of the knowledge that is in the earth, beloved, has been stolen by fallen angels and given to their own chelas and their own initiates on the left-handed path. This is difficult to avoid, for these fallen angels live thousands of years, and therefore they are here when civilizations rise and after they fall and when they rise again. And so they very easily inject into the earth and into their fallen ones the misuses of technology, science, invention, of the arts, and even of the DNA. So that is as it is, but they are shortly coming, one by one, day by day, century by century, to their termination, unless, of course, they bend the knee, confess their sins, confess the Lord Christ as their Lord and Savior, and are willing to pay to the last farthing every karma that they have made. Very few are willing to do this. It is too hard. And they are already addicted to their tranquilizers, to their drugs, to their needles. And it is easier to commit suicide, ultimate spiritual and physical suicide, than to retrace all those footsteps where they have gone out of the way since they left the great central sun. Beloved hearts, then, know the meaning of the path of the wisdom of God, and know that it is laid upon the foundation that begins with faith and with trust. I would speak to you then of trust. Trust in yourself. Trust that you can be a chela on the path. A good portion of self-confidence. Trust then in Nel Moria. Trust in your I Am presence and Holy Christ Self. And trust in God. When you begin to dig and turn over and over the layers of the unconscious and the subconscious, and you find such a heap of troubles and cross currents of energy within your being, I say take recourse to the heart, of the Blessed Mary and the heart of Kuan Yin, for here you have the Immaculate Heart that sees the original blueprint and understands the original point of the soul's perfection, and also understands with the compassion of a mother's heart how you went out of the way and how you can untangle all of those cross currents of warring in your members, warring with your God, warring with people around you. Such is the tremendous power of intercession of the Blessed Mary. And then you go to the merciful heart of Kuan Yin, and you understand that mercy is as mercy does. And if there is anything at all you can do to consume as quickly as possible the records of agony and pain and abuse within the unconscious, it is surely to extend mercy to every other part of life, and to have such a profound, compassionate sense of mercy toward those who have gone astray, that you can say to yourself, there, but for the grace of God go I will extend mercy, for no matter what problems I am going through, I know that that one needs me now with that tender, merciful, supporting presence to get me out of this self-condemnation, even this bitterness toward parents, toward God, toward whatever. So you see, beloved, the Immaculate Heart combined with the Merciful Heart. This is why we have intertwined the 14 stations of the cross for the woman and her seed betwixt these two heavenly beings. There is a great value in the mysteries of the mantras of Kuan Yin, for you set yourself in the minds of those, the ancient ones of China, whose language was similar to present-day Chinese, and therefore you begin to enter into and access the Fohatic keys of wisdom that come to you through the ancient mantras. And then you go back to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, one with Jesus, one with all the saints of Christendom, and if it is to be known, all the saints of all the earth. For Mary, as well as Kuan Yin, our world mothers, are the full manifestation and chalicing of the Divine Mother. So, beloved ones, you see then the unleashing of the floodgates of wisdom is quite an initiation, and it does not happen all at once, but the opening of those floodgates allows little by little, and more, as you make it your goal and your calling to be in harmony in the will of God. And the heavens are open to you, and the spheres of your causal body, where that great wisdom is stored. And the mind of God is open to you. And as you pursue the calls to Cyclopea, not only is the mind opened, but the spiritual eye is opened. And you have knowledge that comes from nowhere except from God. Knowledge of things in the earth, knowledge of prophecy, knowledge whereby you suddenly may master this or that subject because you are such a devotee of God. Moving on then from the place of El Moria to the second ray is a very important step, and it is not allowed until you have passed many, many initiations. Yes, you can take the light and the science stolen by the fallen angels, but it will never be endowed with the flame of the Ark of the Covenant, which is why much intellectual knowledge is often brittle and sometimes boring, tiring, because it is not endowed with the Holy Spirit, because those who have bought it have gone in by another door. They have not entered in the true door of the Christ. And so the intellect can rave on and on. It can strut about and show its prowess and all that it has achieved. But the intellect without heart is as nothing. And what can you take with you of an accumulation of a lifetime or lifetimes of knowledge, intellectual knowledge, if that knowledge is not endowed with a heart flame, with the values of the will of God, with the values of wise dominion and submission of the soul to God. Now I say to you, beloved, with a turmoil in the subconscious and the unconscious and things you are turning over, it is very important to douse it with heavy doses of violet flame, to take the opportunity to give Kuan Yin's rosary once a month on the third Saturdays, beginning early in the morning, to complete that ritual, walk those stations, feel the softening of the heart, and know a new love for all people coming into your soul. This truly is the sign of the adept. The adept is the one of highest love, not of highest intellect. And yet the one who has the highest love will acquire the knowledge of the things of God as well as the knowledge of the things of this world and can be very effective on the path of righteousness. I would suggest humbly, for even we as Elohim are humble before the tiny flame that burns in your heart. I would suggest, beloved, that having so given your honor and gratitude to Sanat Kumara, that you forget not your El Moria, that you recognize that he carries the weight of the divine dispensations for the perpetuation of your individual chelaship and your individual community, that he can do so much more for you, but you must not take him for granted or enter into areas of mistrust when you see that those things that you are pounding your fists on the table for or stomping your feet for are not happening to you overnight. And therefore you begin to lose trust in the master and forget, 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 as the force would have you forget that there are tests to be passed. Thus I should say to you, beloved, that it is time for you to remember that every Tuesday is Moria's day. And if you want all problems solved in your life, then let every one of you, and those of you who right now think you are excluded, well, you are not. Let every one of you come here by 5 or 5:30 in the morning on Tuesday and give all of your love and your heart and the will of God decrees until it is time for breakfast and work. And know that plugging in on those Tuesdays is building the momentum for the fourth of each month. And I tell you, beloved, if you could see how Moria turns heaven and earth upside down for you and lists his own angels, the angels of God Mercury and the angels of everyone that he can possibly call upon. Why, he knocks on the doors of countless ones throughout the hierarchy saying, may I borrow your angels? May I take them to Montana? May I use them in this war against this or that or the next thing? Beloved hearts, if you are as dedicated to El Moria as he is to you, then, and if you knew what he does go through to sustain this community, you would not even think twice about retiring early on Monday and getting into that court and giving him those decrees, and then that Tuesday evening returning for Moria's sake. And then on the fourth, be willing to do what you would have been willing to do before you found this teaching, as the messenger has said to God before she found Saint Germain. I would crawl on my belly all the way around the earth just to find the ascended masters and their path. Blessed ones, how much do you want the sponsorship of El Moria? Well, I tell you, think about it. And then think to yourself how much you as a Chela will sponsor El Moria, will trust him, will rejoice in him, will know that whatever he is doing, he is working out the purposes of God in your life as much as you will let him. I say, let us inaugurate the remainder of the spring cycle unto the July conference with a renewed dedication to that heart, that diamond heart of light that will take you, beloved, where you want to go as long as where you want to go is the will of God. Our counsel to you from the retreat of wisdom of Apollo and Lumina is to lock into the heart of your divine spouse, El Moria, your guru, and to determine to be in that will of God until all things in your life come into place, every piece in the puzzle. Let the Zen Master Moria have his day in your heart and see what he can do for you and you can do for him. We, Apollo and Lumina, seal this conference, and we seal it in the greatest heart of all, the heart of Almighty God, who has given to us the heart of El Moria and his Chelas.
Thank you.